The military invents a lot of things, and not all of them are new types of guns. They're all about making things as efficient as possible, and every once in a while they come up with a product so good it ends up bleeding into civilian life and becoming entwined with our daily lives. As a result of this, you've likely used many of the inventions in today's video that at one point were in a top secret military installation somewhere. Inventions like... Number 10. GPS. Remember the awful days of yesteryear where everyone had to rely on mere maps to find their way from point A to point B? Back then, that process often involved accidental detours via points C, D, and somehow W before you ended up where you were supposed to be going. GPS changed all of that, and as long as your equipment holds up, an array of satellites can now guide you from Kansas to Guatemala without a hitch. Truly, we do live in the future. The US military recognized the need for global navigation that didn't involve asking directions from old men leaning on fences every other mile in 1964. The Cold War was in full swing, and Naval Research Laboratory scientist Roger Easton started tinkering with a system to figure out just what kinds of satellites the Soviet Union was flying up there. He initially tinkered with ground-based tracking stations, but a breakthrough came when he realized putting highly accurate clocks on multiple tracking satellites would allow them to sync their tracking data with each other with much better accuracy. Over the next decade, he fashioned a system called Navigation System Using Satellites and Passive Ranging Techniques, which already incorporated all of the main features of the Global Positioning System. The Department of Defense approved funding for Easton's invention, now called Navstar Global Positioning System, in 1973, and it was built bit by bit over the next 20 years. Eventually, the government realized that the public would benefit from the system as well, and after a trickle-down period where watered-down selective availability versions of GPS were available to the public, the Clinton administration opened the floodgates. Today, the system is freely available, though it's still maintained by the military. The annual operating costs of $900 million or so are paid for by the US Department of Defense and the US Transportation Department. Number 9. Superglue. Superglue is a World War II invention that got its start with Eastman Kodak scientists as part of their attempts to design gun sights for the military. Don't worry though, they weren't trying to glue gun parts together. Instead, they found that some of the things they'd come up with during the project had some pretty interesting properties and revisited said substances to create the adhesive. The man who finally put together the recipe for superglue was named Harry Coover, but he didn't see his invention make its breakthrough until the Vietnam War, when undersupplied, desperate field medics got hold of the substance and used it as a sprayable version to stop bleeding in chest wounds and other serious injuries. While this was effective, early versions of superglue were decidedly not FDA approved and could lead to skin irritation and assorted serious issues when in contact with open wounds. Later versions of the compound were created to specifically deal with the human body, though, as we're sure you'd agree, they're pretty handy for fixing other broken stuff as well. Number 8. Canned food. Canned food is a surprisingly old military invention that actually dates back to 1795. Napoleon Bonaparte offered a hefty prize for whoever could figure out how to preserve food efficiently, because it turns out invading foreign countries was not the greatest way to have said country readily feed the invaders. The prize went unclaimed for 15 years, until a confectioner called Nicolas François Appert claimed it with his newfangled method of heating, boiling, and sealing food in glass jars. This innovative approach was soon improved upon by an Englishman named Peter Durand, who came up with a thick iron food storage can that was lined with tin. Ironically, it would take almost 50 more years before Ezra J. Warner would invent the can opener. The final touches to the canned food technology we all know came from the military. This time, the Natick Soldier System Center, a US Army facility that investigates ways to make rations last longer and taste good. Incidentally, the same facility is also behind the processed cheese that's used to make Cheetos. Number 7. Blood transfusions. To be perfectly honest, blood transfusions weren't technically invented by the military, which has historically been more interested in removing blood from people than figuring out how to put it back. However, World War II military medicine was definitely the contributing factor in figuring out how to do it in a relatively safe and moderately non-horrifying way. Before 1913, the most advanced version of blood transfusion was to surgically dig up the donor's and recipient's veins and suture them together. It didn't really help that no one had really figured out how to deal with blood clotting, and the ABO blood grouping was still a fairly new invention that many in the medical community treated as newfangled nonsense. Between 1913 and 1915, people started to figure out anticoagulants, blood bottles, and donors, and World War I gave doctors ample opportunities to try out these new methods and hone them to perfection. The thing is, most of these advancements had come from North American researchers, so before they joined the fray with new blood transfusion technology, the British and French doctors from other countries largely ignored the procedure, and when they actually tried it with their old methods, well, let's just say they were soon ready to adopt the new ones. Number 6. Ambulances. Like canned food, ambulances are a direct product of Napoleon's penchant for waging war. French surgeon Baron Dominique Jean Larry fought in the majority of the campaigns during the Napoleonic Wars and became convinced that rapid treatment of wounded soldiers was best for everyone involved. This was a nimble horse-drawn cart that was specifically designed to move quickly and efficiently across the battlefield, picking up the wounded and rushing them to field hospitals outside the battle area. Baron Larry's dedication to the wounded was especially admirable because his many military higher-ups of the era thought that injured men were an unnecessary waste of supplies. As you can probably guess, he made a lot of powerful enemies thanks to his pesky humanitarian attitude. Fortunately, Napoleon himself had nothing but respect for Larry, and the Emperor's armies absolutely adored the Baron who fought so hard to treat them. In fact, Larry's strong principles and insistence that medics would treat wounded enemies as well once saved his own life. When Larry was wounded and captured in the aftermath of the Battle of Waterloo, the enemy soldiers were about to shoot him when a medic who was blindfolding him realized who he was. Larry was immediately sent off to the general of the Prussian forces, where he found out it actually saved the general's son's life after an earlier battle. Instead of a swift execution, Baron Larry received a dinner and was released back to his own people with some money and an escort. Number 5. Wristwatches. The first wristwatches were initially treated as a laughable joke item of their day. In 1916, the New York Times led the charge of sensible, pocket watch-using Americans scoffing at the wacky European dandies who had started wearing bracelets with clocks on them. Vaudeville artists and early movie actors utilized wristwatches as comedy props, and the whole thing was treated as a bit of a fad. However, when the Great War rolled around, wristwatches stopped being a laughing matter. Telephones and signal devices required users who knew what time it was, and the only practical way a soldier could wear a timepiece that they could check at a quick glance was on the wrist. The joke item was suddenly deathly serious, and European troops were fitting their watches with unbreakable glass and radium displays for nighttime use. The practical benefits of the wristwatch were now too obvious to ignore, and civilians started to use them as well. Number 4. The electric computer. While it's true that the computer was technically invented by Charles Babbage, a 19th century mathematician who built a crude mechanical calculator called the difference engine, the era of the electric computer didn't kick off until 1944, when Great Britain's codebreakers unleashed the Colossus to crack Nazi messages during World War II. Instead of the famous Enigma code, the Colossus focused on the less known but even more important Fish transmissions that were based on electric teleprinter technology. Fish messages were largely reliant on a cipher machine called Tunny, which used binary code in its encryption. Although Alan Turing figured out a method to crack Tunny's cipher in 1942, British codebreakers found it too slow to keep up with the constant tsunami of encrypted messages. All this changed in 1944 when a post office truck delivered Colossus 1 to their Bletchley Park headquarters. The giant machine and its 8 subsequent Mark II siblings were the first truly electric computers that used a clock pulse to synchronize processing steps and proceeded to crack Tunny code so swiftly and effectively that they were able to help provide crucial information for the Allies' D-Day preparations and subsequent push towards Berlin. After the war, parts of the Colossus computer were transferred to the University of Manchester, where they served as a basis for their successor, Baby, the ancestor of modern all-purpose computers. Number 3. The microwave oven. So at this point, you might be thinking, well, what on earth does this have to do with the military? How do they use microwave ovens? Well, it goes like this. In 1946, an engineer named Percy Spencer was developing a new way to mass-produce radar magnetrons. He was busy testing a military-grade magnetron when suddenly he noticed that a peanut cluster bar he had in his pocket had turned unexpectedly melty because of the microwaves the device emitted. Fascinated by this unexpected development, Spencer tested the magnetron on an egg, which promptly exploded on his face. After that, he moved on to popcorn kernels and ended up inventing microwave popcorn. While Spencer himself wasn't particularly concerned about the potential danger microwaves posed on him during his tests, since the very first commercial microwave oven debuted just 1 year after the initial discovery, initially the device didn't catch on, probably because it weighed 750 pounds and was incredibly expensive at £2,000, which is, well, a lot more today. In the end, it took until 1967 and the emergence of the compact Radarange oven for the technology to make its commercial breakthrough. Number 2. The Internet. ARPANET was a military project. Yes, even the World Wide Web you're watching this video on right now is a military invention, or rather, its predecessor, ARPANET, is. ARPANET is largely the product of the U.S. Defense Department's well-financed research agency called the Advanced Research Projects Agency, as in ARPA. Probably see where the name comes from. The ARPANET network was built in 1969 to connect the mainframes of various universities, defense contractors, and government institutions throughout the country, and its ultimate aim was to bring computing to the front lines. ARPANET never quite achieved this because, while it was quite effective, its locations were completely fixed and the computers required to operate it were absolutely massive. However, the existence of the system left ARPA scientists plenty of room to tinker, and in 1974, two researchers named Robert Kahn and Vint Cerf sowed the seeds of the Internet proper by creating the blueprint of the first Internet protocol. Only 2 years later, the seemingly impossible Internet had started working. An extra fun fact here, ARPA later changed its name to the Defense Advanced Research Projects Agency, or DARPA, and yes, that's the same DARPA that has been the focus of various conspiracy theories. For example, among other things, its involvement in the so-called weather control program HAARP. Number 1. Duct tape. Duct tape, if anything, seems like a military invention. It can fix pretty much anything you can name and seems custom-made for use in the field. However, military scientists had absolutely nothing to do with its original concept. The idea came in 1943 from an ammunition packer named Vester Stout, whose two sons were serving in the US Navy and who was quite keen on keeping them alive. She noticed that the ammo packages were sealed with thin paper tape and opened with a tab that frequently tore off, which left soldiers scrambling to open the packages, potentially at the cost of their lives. Stout brought her concerns to her superiors and offered a solution: a strong cloth-based waterproof tape that would efficiently seal the boxes shut. But the superiors, they didn't listen. So she decided to take matters into her own hands and wrote a letter to President Franklin D. Roosevelt himself. In her letter, she described the issue and offered her tape idea as a solution, complete with diagrams. Roosevelt was so impressed with Stout that he immediately passed the letter on to the War Production Board, and soon Stout was showered with letters from political and military big shots who kept her in the loop about the developments and asked her to send them any more ideas she might have in the future. The tape was approved for production with exceptional merit, and the military immediately fell in love with it. They dubbed the new invention the 100 bar per hour tape and use it to this day to fix everything from boots to Jeeps. And it's probably fair to say that the public quite like the tape as well. So I really hope you found that video interesting. If you did, please do hit that thumbs up button below and do not forget to subscribe. We got brand new videos just like this every day of the week. If you want even more than that though, from me there's another channel called Biographics that I do. I'm going to link to that below. And as always, thank you for watching.